is this the dagger?
Illegal substitution, too many men on the field, Saskatchewan.
Gizmo has a block and the sideline. He has not stepped out, he may go all the way. He needs one block and he'll do it easily.
Promise mess, I wouldn't do this.
McDavid stops up, what a move, shoots, scores!
It's another edition of The Outsiders. Podcast number 40, Bryn Griffiths along with Robin Brownlee. How are you doing today?
I'm excellent. Ready to roll, Bryn.
Yeah, we have two guests joining us on the program today. I'm looking very much forward to talking with the new Director of Communications for the Edmonton Oilers, Jamie Cartmell. And I'm really going to be kind of curious to see how he handles the superstars that the Edmonton Oilers have, Connor McDavid and Leon Draisaitl, because that's going to keep him busy. I'm sure he's got a thought or two on that coming up. Plus, he's also got a history with the Edmonton Eskimos and then went to the British Columbia Lions and was there for a good deal of time out in Vancouver before getting this great gig, and he's going to do a fantastic job at it. I'm convinced of that.
Oh, no question. Hey, and an Edmonton guy who, you know, started here, went out to Vancouver for 14 or 15 years, and now he's back. And in this town, I can't imagine a better gig than what he's got with the Edmonton Oilers. That's the big game in town, and he's back home running that communications show. I'm looking forward to it.
I always felt doing that gig in that position that you were dealing with, if not the number one brand in the city, the number two brand easily in the city. I'm thinking that the city of Edmonton is probably the only bigger brand than that of the Edmonton Oilers. And I'm not convinced that it's 1-2 that way, because if you go to Europe and you mention you're from Edmonton, they immediately start talking about the hockey club. So it's going to be a gigantic challenge for him. And I'm pretty sure that he can raise his game to that position. The other guy that we have joining us on the broadcast is Kyle Brodziak, a former Edmonton Oiler, who's going to be taking part in the world's longest game of hockey coming up. We'll get into that a little bit later on. But there is a common theme here between these two guys, Robin.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, you know, we just mentioned Jamie came here. He worked, cut his teeth in the comms business with the football club, and then went out to the coast for 14 or 15 years. Experience never hurts. And now he's back home with a great gig, you know, in front of him. Kyle Brodziak, 214th player drafted in the 2003 entry draft. That's a long shot no matter how you slice it. Made his way to the Edmonton Oilers, ended up leaving town, made NHL stops, mainly Minnesota, St. Louis, came back to Edmonton, played a year, forced out a year early on his contract because of a bad back. He's settled in the area now. Be interesting to talk to him about the journey he made and what's next.
Okay, let's get to a couple of hot topics before we get to Jamie Cartmell. And I guess the biggest one, last week we were talking about the gold medal matchup coming up at the World Junior Hockey Championship. We weren't completely sure who'd be in the gold medal final, but it ended up being the excited States of America against Canada. And we were talking a little bit about the fact that Canada was a little mercurial, I guess is probably the best word, through there. They were in the what we call the weaker pool. And it just seemed like they were playing to the level of their competition. But it's still, that was still a really solidly put together team. But then they take on the Americans who were in the tougher pool and had to scramble and struggle and elevate their game. And sure enough, by the time they got to the gold medal matchup, Canada could not find the accelerator pedal while the U.S. looked good on their way to a gold medal final. But the one thing that I wanted to touch on, Robin, is I always get a little pissed off at the fact that so Canada, or we, didn't win the gold medal, so everybody wants to slam our guys and say, well, you know what, we never played if we'd have been in the harder pool, it might have been better for us. Well, you know what, the Americans had to get through the hard pool just to get to the gold medal final, and nobody's given them any credit. And I thought they played fantastic in that game against Canada.
Yeah, this just in, the Americans are pretty good.
Yeah.
They full marks for it. You know what? And 1 year doesn't matter to the next so much over a period of time. But the Americans, when the money's on the table, when the medals are on the table, have Canada's number. And that's not a fluke. They've played well. They played well this time. Canada wasn't at its best, but they weren't awful. They had one game to play. They played in the pools that they did. That doesn't matter. When you get to the gold medal game, mano a mano. And
bring it.
The U.S. was the better club.
Yeah.
They get the gold. Canada gets the silver. That's how it works.
It's also very, very difficult these days to repeat as champion. We've seen that over the last 10 years. Okay, yep. A couple other little tidbits to throw out here. You and I were very excited to hear news today from the Coyotes down in Phoenix that they've hired a new person to be their chief hockey development officer. Who is it?
Oh, was it Steve Kelly?
No, it is not. It's Shane Doan, and you know it. And I'm very happy for Doaner. That's a great hire for them.
Yes, it is. You know what? Made himself a great career down there. You know, when the franchise moved to the desert. And, you know, Shane Doan did everything he wanted to do in hockey. He made a ton of dough. But here he is back in hockey ops with the Arizona Coyotes. So good for him. He's a rink rat, always will be. And not surprised that he'd catch on with the club he played for so long.
All the way from Warthog, Alberta. Oh, sorry, no, it wasn't Warthog. It was, what was the name of the place? Halkirk. Sorry, Warthog.
Yeah.
I just said that
Warthog.
For fun. Anyway, so congratulations to Doaner for that. Yeah. That's fantastic. Okay, so the NHL season starts up this week. The Edmonton Oilers, the Calgary Flames, the Vancouver Canucks, Winnipeg Jets, Toronto Maple Leafs, Ottawa Senators, and the Montreal Canadiens will show and strut their stuff in the Scotia North Division. I'm not talking Honda West Division. I'm not talking about the Discover Central Division. And I'm certainly not talking about the Mass Mutual Eastern Division, as the NHL have decided to sell the names to their division. Oh my God, the uproar last week over that announcement. And I'm thinking, it was the Barclays English Premier League for years. Leagues and various sports have been doing this for a long time. The NHL is just catching up.
Well, this just in, the NHL is looking for ways to generate revenue this season,
yeah,
because nobody's in the building. So, you know what? No big surprise. I was laughing a few weeks ago when the talk first started about advertising on helmets. Has anybody, wondering if that's a good idea, looked at a picture of a European game in the last 25 years? It's no big deal. You know what? If it stays because it's a good idea, it'll stay. If it's only a 1 year thing because revenues are low, or 2 year thing, let it be. It's not desecrating hockey. It's raising ad revenue, which all NHL teams sorely need right now.
Well,
it's fine.
It's here to stay, and the jerseys are next. Pants maybe the next thing, but
yep.
I still remember when we went through this with board signs, and everybody wondered how long they were going to stick with that. Well, now you don't even notice it. You won't even notice a Rogers sticker on the helmet of Connor McDavid if you're watching what he's doing on the ice. So it's a lot, to me, it's a lot of chirping by a lot of people, and it will go away at some point. Hey, and before we go, I had the opportunity to watch part one on HBO 2. It was part one of the Tiger Woods story. And I thought I knew a lot about Tiger Woods, because I want to talk about a guy who, his story's been out there for quite some time because of his dominance in that particular sport. Mm-hmm. But I was blown away. But as I tweeted out, I said, great front nine, because we have a second part coming up here within a week. But if you get a chance to download it or stream it, I'd highly suggest you do it. Whether you're just a casual golf fan or a fanatical golf fan, do it, because you might look at Tiger just a little differently. And I know that I watched it and I went, I never knew that. And if a documentary can do that, for me to say, oh, I never saw that coming, then I think it's doing a really great job. I can hardly wait for part two, but I just wanted to recommend it because I thought it was pretty fantastic.
Well, I tell you what, a guy like Tiger Woods doesn't do anything that goes unnoticed. I haven't seen it. I certainly plan to. I just remember when things started to unravel for him, the joke was, well, did she use a one iron or a three iron to knock his teeth down his throat? I guess there's a story behind everything.
Oh, yeah.
And if you want the whole one, it sounds like this little series might be something worth taking in.
Well, there are a few things uncovered that make a few other things make a little more sense. And that's what I sat there and I went, ooh, okay, I never knew that. That's something new for me. Anyway, if you get a chance, I would highly recommend you catch that Tiger Woods HBO documentary. Okay, let's get to our guests right away here because we got a lot of stuff coming up. Coming up next, we're going to be chatting with the new director of communications for the Edmonton Oilers, and that is Jamie Cartmell, who's got a great past history, has a real connection to a good friend of ours, Dave Jamieson. He'll talk about that. Also, we had a chance to talk to Jamie earlier, and we wanted to know, how are you going to handle the two superstars? Because the media are going to want a lot of Connor, and they're going to want a lot from Leon. So he had his thoughts on that as well, and we'll get right to that. Let's go back a little bit before we start talking about the Oilers. How many years with the Edmonton Eskimos for you?
Four seasons with the Eskimos, 2002 to 2005. And then 14 seasons with the BC Lions, 06 to 2019.
You had the pleasure of working with Dave Jamieson for a good chunk of that with the football club here in Edmonton. How did that whole thing go?
I don't want to cry. So, Dave is, I, the words don't describe Dave. He's, you know, and I'm going to cry. No, he's a friend and a mentor. And I wouldn't be here without him. So yeah, it's tough. Sorry about that.
No, it's all right, man.
Yeah. I don't know what to say about Dave. Like, it's just, it's unbelievable. And so, you know, I'm here and I've got Sean May, who's here, and he worked for Dave as well with the Eskimos. And like, I'll be honest with you, like, all through the interview process with the Oilers and stuff, you know, Dave was, he was making calls and talking to people, and you know, and he, you know, giving me inside information on, you know, Bob Nicholson and Ken Holland, and just, you know, talking to the media and seeing, you know, where there are potential lapses or things they need to sort of be, you know, rectified, or, you know, how they view things and what their needs are. And it gave me, you know, there's, from what I was told, there was close to 120 people that applied for this position. So I probably, you know, I like to think I got it on some of my merit, but without Dave's insight and everything else, you know, it would have been tough. So I went to him and the people gave me the job, obviously, but Dave was a huge, huge, still is.
Well, you know what, Jamie, you don't get this shot unless you deserve it. And you're right about J-Mo. He's a terrific guy. One of the fun things for me would be to come over and help with on the Eskimo beat once my time was up, you know, after hockey season and that. And I mean, Dave did a terrific job. And to be honest, I thought so did you. I'm thinking at that point, I'm the Oilers beat guy. Who's this young guy helping J-Mo? But it became curious after a while who this young guy was. You go out to Vancouver, you do a really good job there. I looked at the feed about after you announced getting this job, and you know what people like Farhan Lalji and all those people that dealt with you out there said. It's no surprise to me that you're here, but man, that's a long time coming, eh? To be able to come back home after all those years.
Yeah, I mean, it's hard. It really is hard to describe. I mean, I'm from here. I grew up with this team. I was, you know, in high school when they were winning Stanley Cups. I mean, there was as both of you can attest, there was no better time to be a sports fan in Edmonton during the heyday of you know, the 80s and early 90s, you know, between the Oilers and the Eskimos, who are held in very high esteem in the city as well, you know, in that time. It was the best. It was the best of times for us as you know, high schoolers growing up with the Oilers and stuff. So to now be here and to, you know, when Kevin Lowe is sending you an email after you get the job saying, you know, congrats, or Craig Simpson, I mean, yeah, you have to kind of pause a little bit. It's strange. I mean, it's not sort of fanboying out, but it's, trust me, I mean, it's very strange. You have to get used to that and just, you know, walk in these halls and in this building, which literally I set foot in for the very first time in my life last week. Like, it's very much a whirlwind, and I'm trying to keep up. But overall, it's been just an incredible experience.
Hey, what did you learn in Vancouver that you think you can bring to the table with the Edmonton Oilers? Because communications is communications. The only difference is maybe, you know, the CFL, the NHL is a little higher up here, but there's still sure, professional leagues, and you still learn a ton. What do you think you learned over your time in Vancouver?
Well, I think you're right. I mean, obviously it's different leagues, and the salaries are different, but I mean, it's still people. And quite honestly, it's the same people covering both leagues in a lot of these cities.
Yeah.
In many ways, but if people describe this as a good hire, it's because I think that they view me as a person who understands that, you know, I work for the club, I work with the media, so you have to kind of ride that line. But at the same time, you just, all it is it's all about relationships. And it doesn't matter if it's in Edmonton, it doesn't matter if it's in Vancouver, it doesn't matter if it's hockey or football. It's all about relationships. It's relationships with the players, relationships with your senior staff, and relationships with the media. And it's just a matter of, you know, that's why they call it public relations or media relations, because you truly are managing relationships. And a big part of those relationships is trust and respect. So no different in your personal life. I mean, so I think I learned in Vancouver that, I don't know, you every day you have to work at maintaining relationships.
Yeah, I mean, that's the, if you're starting with that on square one, you've got it down pat, because really, bottom line, that's what it is. Jamie, we chatted briefly this morning before you came on with us. I was noting, you know, the Oilers were in that Stanley Cup final, which is as close as they've been since you left, and they've gone through 7 coaches and 5 general managers since you left. And those glory days, you can never take them away, but they're well in the rearview mirror. And now you're working with a bunch of people. You know, Kevin Lowe is still with the Oilers, although not directly in hockey ops, but Ken Holland and Dave Tippett. The cast of characters is largely different, but it's still the National Hockey League and it's still the Edmonton Oilers. As a kid, did you ever think it would unfold like this? I mean, were you a kid who said one day, man, I'd love to work with the Edmonton Oilers, because if playing isn't your thing, the next best thing is being with the team one way or another?
You know what's funny is I remember, so my dad, you know, we didn't have season tickets or anything, so we saw the odd game here and there. We also saw, you know, a number of WHA games. I remember seeing, you know, Messier come in here as a Cincinnati Stinger and things like that. But, you know, we saw games where, you know, Wayne had signed all the contracts as a, whatever it was, 19-year-old or 20-year-old. So I went to some pretty interesting games. I just remember having that picture, because everyone got a complimentary picture, autographed picture of Wayne from that day where he signed that famous picture of him signing, you know, the cake, center ice, and signing the contracts and stuff. And I said, yeah, I'm going to play. I'm going to play with him one day, Dad. There's my dad. Oh, yeah, okay. We'll see about that. But, yeah, I mean, admittedly, I think the communication side of things, or working with the club, I mean, I don't know if I envisioned that as a kid. I think that was sort of just, I think I wanted to work in sports from sort of a late teens. And I got into some interesting opportunities. I worked at the World Junior Basketball Championships that rolled through Edmonton in the early 90s. I think it was 92 or 93. Got to meet, you know, scouts from the NBA and, you know, the director of scouting for the NBA, Marty Blake. And they all gave me
glowing letters of recommendation that I tried and talking to them. And I tried to sort of do something with the Spokane Chiefs at one point. And so I was always kind of, just sort of trying to get my footing somewhere. Eventually went back to school, went to Grant McHugh and did the public relations program there. And I mean, I'm not a big believer in luck. I think there can be fortunate circumstances or fortunate timing, but I'm not a big believer in luck, because I think that if you are someone who's depending on luck to get somewhere, then you're not really being sort of, honest with yourself if things don't work out, because you just blame it on bad luck, And I think that while I think it was sort of in the back of my mind and something that I thought, well, that's not likely to happen, but go and see Bryn Griffiths and see what's going on. Maybe there'll be something, or at least show some interest. And fortunately, there was something at the Eskimos at the time in 2002. And like you say, came in and I looked after accumulations and I was an assistant to Dave, and the timing worked out. And then, BC, the situation, the timing worked out. But you don't get the job because of luck. You get the job because you're qualified for, you're qualified for the job. And that's why I believe in fortunate circumstances and timing and other people's circumstances that lead to you getting an opportunity. But in the end, you have to have the merits to do the job. So I think along the way, I probably wasn't ready 20 years ago, obviously. But it took 20 years to get back, and here I am.
Well, when you sat with me in my office in Oilerland, the fact that you were so well-driven, I knew you were going to land on your feet somewhere. It's just there was no position when you came in and we chatted. But I still remember that conversation vividly, and it was a lot of fun. And it's great for me to pick your brain as much as you were picking mine. But now you're coming into a situation here. You have to deal with the media, and you also now have two superstars on your hands who are going to take a lot of your time. And Sean May is another guy you work with who's fantastic. And now it's almost like you got to give Sean the hockey club while you look after the two superstars, because the way things are going to work, these two guys are going to take a ton of your time, and you know that.
Yes. Would be the short answer. But, there's some nuance to it, too. I mean, I don't want to be in Connor's world every day, and I'm sure he doesn't want me in his world every day. So I think for us, it's just a matter of sort of, we need to have a plan, for those guys, and we need to be respectful of their time. And in the end, I want to win, I'd like to get a ring. I've been fortunate to get four Grey Cup rings. I'd really like to get a ring. So part of my job is to remove distractions from Coach Tippett's world and remove distractions from Connor and Leon's world, while at the same time being respectful of a president who would like to sell the building out once we have fans back. So, and the media is the conduit to the fans. And so, you have to sort of do both. And in terms of dealing with, Connor and Leon specifically, and I'm sort of giving you insight on how you do this job, but you can't just be in their world immediately from day one.
Right.
You have to build a relationship with them. They don't know who I am, and so I have to build that relationship with them. And that takes process. Might take the whole season. But I think for me, you could call it a strategy. Like my thing with, and I do have to really sit down with both Connor and Leon, is things like, well, let's sort of have a plan at the beginning of the week, so you're not surprised by anything. Here's what we're going to do. Let's try and do it so you're not both doing stuff on the same day, so you have a day off and the other guy can do stuff. And, it can kind of work that way. But I think, again, it comes back to that same old thing. Communication, relationships, trust, planning ahead, being on the same page, no surprises, remove distractions, and just let it kind of be. I mean, there's going to be times where, if the club wins 4-1 and Connor's either, has an assist or he's off the score sheet, he doesn't need to speak every night.
Yeah.
But unfortunately, you do have those nights where the club loses, 8-2. And that's where your captain has to be out front. He understands that. He knows that. That's the expectation that's been given to him by people far above me. So he knows that, but sometimes you're at game, let's say in a regular season, like a normal regular season, when you're in game, 68, sometimes you have to go and look at each other and say, remember our plan back in October or November? Well, here's one of those tough nights. Anybody can do it on the easy night, but you know, the pros are, or they step up and do it on the nights that aren't so fun, you know, and he's young. They're all young. So,
hey,
you have to take that into perspective as well.
You know what? And just to make that perfectly clear, the only time we ever really talked to Mark Messier back in the old days when we were broadcasting or the writers or whatever, we only ever saw Mess after losses, and he spoke on behalf of the club. If things were going well, he always deflected it to the other guys, unless he scored three or four goals that particular night. So I completely get what you're saying with that. And that's a great strategy. You're well positioned, man. I it's great to hear.
Yeah. Well, yeah, you have to have a plan. I mean, like, admittedly, like yesterday, you know, it was on a Sunday. I'm not sure when we're airing this, but on a Sunday from my home, I texted Connor and just said, here's what we plan. Here's what we have for the week. We're going to do this. You know, it's we'll make you available on Monday after the skate. Tuesday we'll have off. Wednesday is game day. It's the first game of the year. We'll do game day skate and probably post game just to sort of, because it's game one. That would be the expectation. It's the first game of the year. It's a very, you know, it's a unique year. He texted back within, I would tell you, without exaggeration, a minute. Sounds good to me. I appreciate the plan. Looks good. So, I mean, he's a pro. And he gets it. He understands his role. He understands his role in his team. He understands his role in the league. I introduced myself to the leadership group in separate texts. Just said, this is my name. This is, you know, I'm doing this now and I'm pleased to meet you. First guy to reply was Connor. Second guy was Leon with exclamation points. Great to have you. Look forward to meeting you. So, like, I mean, I don't know what to tell you. I don't know if you can ask for a better start.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah, it's just that's what you have to do. But again, like, we also gave Connor, you know, 5 days off. He did his Sunday availability, the first day of training camp. He didn't do anything again until Friday. I know that he appreciates that. We're out of his orbit. We pop in. Hey, we're good today. He knows. He said, okay, yeah, I haven't done anything for 5 days. That's fair. You know,
yeah.
As long as he's, you know, you have to respect their time. I mean, it's, trust me, I see the time these guys put in. I mean, it is. They are all in all the time. They're here late. They're here early. It's everything. And there's a lot of pressure. There's a lot of pressure to win in this league. There's a lot of pressure for everybody. And, but I can't say enough how great everybody in this organization has been since day one.
Well, Jamie, I tell you, we talked about, you know, this is about relationships and that never changes, but what has changed in the last, well, just a couple years, but you go back to when you were first getting into the game with the Eskimos, the technology to deliver the message has changed. And now, specifically to the circumstances, now COVID-19 changed everything where access to players and coaches became through Zoom in the play-in and playoffs. I don't know if things get back to normal and when they do, what that normal looks like, but what are the challenges here today with you and everybody else in your position around the National Hockey League with communicating and getting the message out under the COVID-19 situation?
Well, that's just it. I mean, first and foremost, if we want to play, you know, there's protocols that are set out and you have to be, you know, we're tested every single day. Everybody's tested in this, you know, I wouldn't call it a bubble, but it's as close to a bubble as you can get. So you have to be very respectful of what's going on. Yeah, I think you also have to realize that I've heard a number of our players talking about this, that there are, let's face it, far more important things that people are facing in their lives right now than the start of an NHL season. So you have to be respectful of that. But in terms of sort of the execution of the job, I mean, it is what it is right now. We're forced to do this by Zoom. So what we have to do is make it the best possible quality that we possibly can. We have to make sure that we have the players there and available. We have to make sure that we execute it in a highly professional manner. And we have to be, we just have to do the best we can do within the circumstances. Like, I don't use words like, oh, good enough, or oh, well, you know, like, no, this is what we're going to do it. So we're going to do it to the best of our ability. And we're going to try and be the best in the league at doing it. We're going to travel with the best possible equipment. We're going to provide the best possible equipment to our opponents when they're here to make sure they can, execute the things they need to do. And we're going to do it to the best, you know, to the best possible degree we can possibly do it at. But I would like to think that as we progress through this and things change and the numbers come down and a vaccine becomes available, that I would hope by next season we could return to some sort of, normality. I don't know. I don't want to start saying the new normal and that kind of thing, but I would like to think that we could have a locker room open, and get that, because this is not a very good working conditions for the media whatsoever. It's still the odd, thing you can do for a writer who can do a one-on-one by phone, which is sort of the old school of doing things sometimes, but the room needs to be open. Those relationships need to be established with the media. There needs to be people around covering your sport. Just the whole idea of doing these Zoom calls and stuff like that. There is an element that's lost. It's not a bad patch given what we're facing right now, but it's not the same. And I think if you're saying, oh, this is just, let's just keep doing it like this, I think you're kind of fooling yourself. I don't think it serves anybody to the fullest degree, but that's where we're at right now. And we'll do the best with what we got.
Hey, and the other thing too, now you got to deal with two guys right out of the Muppet Show doing a podcast. And awesome. And we love it. It's the media's changed too. There was traditional mainstream media, but now you got a lot of different ways to get your story out. And we thank you for your time today, because we know the season's coming fast, and we're gonna let you get right back at it. But we will be talking with you, I'm sure, numerous times throughout the season, and we look forward to it.
Oh, I look forward to it anytime. I'm happy to help. I hope the ratings don't go down too much for you.
No, it'll be fine. This is great stuff today, Jamie. Thanks again. I don't know if it's fair to say he's the pride and joy of St. Paul, Alberta or not. Kyle Brodziak joins us on the show. Were you just born there, or did you grow up there a little bit, Kyle?
I lived in St. Paul. I think I was seven when my family moved to Beggarville. But yeah, I still have tons of family in St. Paul, so definitely consider that home as well.
So pride and joy of there and Beggarville. You got it covered, man.
I Beggarville, my mom still lives in Beggarville. All my best buddies I grew up with are from there, and I make it back there, every once in a while. Obviously now it's been a little more difficult with the times we're living in now, but still very close.
Kyle, we end up saying this a lot on this podcast, Bryn and I have been around a while, and the saying is time flies. I remember you. Well, I mean, you're a 214th draft pick overall back in 2003. 214th, and we didn't touch on this, but just in case you were wondering, because I'm sure you don't stay up at night thinking about this, there are all of 18 players from that draft year who played 917 games like you did. 18. Everybody but one of them was in the first or second round. The only guy who's like you, he was like a few picks before you, was Joe Pavelski.
Yeah, I knew that one.
Yeah. So, look, you took the long road to the National Hockey League. I remember you on that American Hockey League Edmonton Roadrunners team. You were one of the youngest guys on that team. All of a sudden, all these years have gone by. You're now retired. You got back to Edmonton for that last season. Talk about that. Talk about that road you took to the National Hockey League to get to where you are today.
Okay, yeah, sure. So, like you said, my first year was Edmonton Roadrunners. That was first taste of pro hockey, and it was kind of an up and down year. We had a pretty decent team, I thought. We the first half of the year we were kind of in the mix, and I think it was not until maybe March when the wheels kind of fell off, February, March, and Yeah, we had a, I remember having a really long road trip, and it was just a miserable trip. Yeah. So that year was kind of a little bit of a bitter taste in that one. Then the next 2 years, still in the minors, got loaned to Iowa my second year, played for the Iowa Stars, which was Dallas's farm team. Then the year after I was, in Wilkes-Barre, the Penguins, Pittsburgh's farm team. Those are the 2 years the Oilers didn't have their own team, so they loaned guys out. And, actually, both they were. You know what? I can't really complain because obviously you're playing in a different system. Early on you might not get the opportunities that some of the other guys get from their organization, but you know what? I really enjoyed both those years and made a lot of good friends, enjoyed both those cities, playing on both those teams. Wilkes-Barre kind of, I remember going there early on. I think I was a healthy scratch the first game. And then, got an opportunity to get in the lineup. I think I scored my first game. And then just, there was just a really fun year. We had a really good team. It was just a really good experience, even though, it could have been maybe a little different, but could have been miserable. You playing in another farm system, but the guys that I was there with, the other Oiler guys, we made the best of it. So, after that, that's when, the next year I made the Oilers out of camp and just never looked back after that. So, I spent a couple of years in Edmonton and got traded to Minnesota. Spent 6 years there. Can't say a bad thing about my time there. It was incredible. And same with St. Louis. I signed as a free agent in St. Louis and ended up staying there for 3 years. And it's the same thing. I don't have a bad thing to say about that place either. Both organizations, both cities, it was just awesome. It was an awesome experience.
Hey, before we go on, you kind of alluded to a long road trip, and I remember going on a 12, 14-dayer when I was working for the Oilers back in the late 90s, and that was painful to be on the road that long. I think it was 6 games in 14 days, but you went on one that was almost twice that long?
It was like 20 days, I think.
24.
24, holy man.
Wow.
Yeah, and we're losing too, so that doesn't help. Yeah,
even worse. So that must have been, how do you get through a trip like that other than the fact that Robin Brownlee's palling around and he's kind of hovering?
Yeah, that trip was all a blur. I think I got a funny story actually. First night of the road trip, I don't know if you remember this story, Robin, but first night of the road trip, we're in Rochester. I believe we're in Rochester and mm-hmm. staying in a hotel. I was roommate. Oh, who was I roommate with? Mike Bischoff.
There you go.
Yeah. So we were roommates. Go to sleep. Wake up in the morning. My wallet's gone. So I, start asking around, looking around. Find out that JJ Hubert's wallet is also gone from his room. So, basically what we found out was in the middle of the night, somebody had broken into our room, stole our wallets. First day of this long road trip. So it didn't really get off to a good start right there. We obviously cancel all your cards, try to order a new credit card, get shipped where, I don't kind of remember where we were the rest of the trip. ID gone, everything gone. Before the end of the road trip, I believe both of our wallets, all of our information got mailed to somebody, must have found them, and they mailed all of our stuff back to JJ's house. So, yeah, it was kind of a wild story. Do you have something you want to add to that?
I got to ask. I think you and I have had a laugh about this before. What was the deal? You showed up for the road trip. I remember a white belt, white shoes, and you kind of had your hair in a comb over as a joke. That's the same trip where, for the hell of it, you showed up on the bus at like 7 a.m. one morning with a whole bunch of razor burn on your head because you thought, hey, why not? I think I'll shave my head with a disposable razor. Talk about that.
So I ran every once in a while. Like right now, I have a shaved head. I like to shave it every once in a while. So I don't know why. I think it was at like midnight or 1 in the morning when I got back to the – when we got to the hotel, decided I was going to shave my head. And I had an electric beard trimmer that I was doing it with. And halfway through, battery died. I couldn't get it charged. I couldn't get enough power in this thing to finish my shaving the rest of my head. So, because we were, I think there was like a 7, like you said, a 7 o'clock, 7 a.m. bus. So I had to figure something out to get the rest of the hair shaved, taken off my head. So I just used a razor. Yeah. It was, that picture you sent, I can't believe you have that picture.
I have.
Those pictures don't go away. Come on.
That was before all the advances in phone technology. So I'm surprised you still had that picture.
Hey, you were talking about, you mentioned Minnesota and you mentioned St. Louis. So you've got Edmonton, Minnesota, St. Louis. I don't know if I can throw Detroit into this category, but those first three cities are often so overlooked sometimes by fans or players as being, I don't know if, that's kind of away from things. But having gone to these places, they're really wonderful places to play. They're great places to visit. And you talked about the fact that you settled in beautifully in both Minnesota and in St. Louis. The Detroit thing, you can address that too. But these are cities that I think are very underrated in a lot of ways. Do you think that's a fair assessment by me?
Absolutely. Minnesota, so my wife and I love the city. We lived in the downtown area for the first 3 years. And then after we had our first boy, we moved into, we bought a house and kind of in the suburb area. But just the city is great. Tons of restaurants. Actually, just lots of action. If you're into that thing, those days are kind of gone for us now. But the people in Minnesota are famously friendly. They say it's pretty much as close to a Canadian city as you're going to get, and we found that to be very true. Where it's everybody there is friendly. That's Minnesota. St. Louis, didn't know much about St. Louis at all. With kind of the downtown areas, you're kind of told to maybe not go out late at night walking around the downtown area, which is probably true. But when we got there, one thing that I couldn't believe was how many St. Louis Blues alumni players had made that their home after hockey.
Yeah.
That was surprising. And then after spending a few years playing there, it's actually really not surprising at all. Once you get out of the downtown area, there's tons of great suburbs that are, the people are friendly. People are very friendly in that city as well. The weather is great there. It was just a good city to raise our family for a few years there. So,
Kyle, again, like we said off the top, I look at you, where you were drafted, how you came up. I mean, the National Hockey League is a long shot, no matter how good you are as a junior. You know how the pyramid works. All the best guys on their team move up, and then there's best guys that come out of that group. And the higher you go, the tougher it is. 917 games. You came to this town as a young guy, a single guy. You're back now. You at least got that last spin with the Oilers back in your home province. It didn't end the way you wanted to because of the back, but you're a father of three now. You're settled into what I think Sherwood Park area. That journey, now that you look back at it, about as good as any kid hoping to make the NHL. could have hoped? And second part of that, how's life for you now? What's a typical day for Kyle Brodziak now?
Okay. Yeah, absolutely. The journey was more than I could have ever expected. I remember it would have been the first year pro with the Roadrunners. Just thinking, man, would it be nice to just play a few games in the NHL? Or just, you know, even one full year would be just incredible. And then, yeah, to get the chance to do it, you know, you're not really thinking, I guess, long-term at that point. Early on in your career, you're just happy to be where you are at that point and try to make the best of it. And, you know, it's definitely different looking back on it. And, you know, I guess playing as long as I did, I never would have expected to play that long. Definitely grateful for that. And yeah, it just, you know, we talked about it earlier before the show, how time flies, and it really did. It flew by, and I had a long career. I'm satisfied with, you know, with, I'm not going to say I'm sad that my career is over. I think I was getting ready for things to wind down when they did. Obviously would have liked to play that last year on my contract, but yeah, that's the way it went. And I have no regrets towards that. And, second part now, I'm just hanging at home and enjoying the home life. And, finally after all these years of traveling, I get to stay home full time and, enjoy my family. I've talked about this with a few other people. The toughest part, I felt like, let's say you're home for a week and you finally get back into that home routine. It just becomes like a cycle where, you know, then you leave and you're gone for a week and then you come home and it's like restarting again. And that's what I think I had the most difficulty with, difficult time with, was just that never ending cycle of you don't ever really get comfortable being at home for long stretches. And now that I've got the opportunity to do that, I'm very grateful for it.
All boys in your household?
All boys. All boys. Yeah.
So now have you gone from a playing career to one of being a referee?
Pretty much. Yep. Yeah, pretty much. That's what it's like all day long here. Just the nonstop arguing and fighting and getting into trouble, but it's fun though.
You know, Brodzi, down the road, you don't need to look too far. I mean, you got those kids to keep you busy, but you've been out of hockey now for a little bit. You got your eye on anything? Do you see yourself, getting back in the game at all? I was looking this morning, a guy who was in the league a long time, the Arizona Coyotes just hired Shane Doan in player development. Yeah, that just came out this morning. So Doner's a rink rat. He always was. I remember him in Kamloops. And so he's back. What about you? What's down the road for you?
Yeah, that's still up in the air. I'm not sure. I've kind of always thought maybe coaching. Getting into coaching. I'm not sure though. I decided early on after hockey was done that I'm not going to think about what I want to do next just yet. I want to really take this time and enjoy the time at home. And eventually I'll figure out when the time is right, what I want to do and what direction I want to go in, but I'm not there yet. Maybe eventually, another year or so at home, I could maybe see starting to get the ball rolling in another direction, but I just don't know. I'm not sure where I want to go with it just yet.
I'm obligated to bring this next part up because having been the voice of the Moose Jaw Warriors for almost five seasons back in the late 80s, if I don't bring up a Moose Jaw question, I hear from all sorts of people in Regina and Moose Jaw, but you played there. Now, you the crush can had was it gone, or were you still playing?
I was there, yeah.
I can't really begin to describe how much fun it was to do broadcasts out of there, but playing there, talking to Theo, talking to Kelly Buchberger, Lyle Odlin, Jim McKenzie and guys like that back in the day. But that was quite the place to play junior.
Oh, it was incredible. If you played for the Warriors,
yes.
Every other player or team that went to that building hated that rink. But if you played there, if that was your home, then it was incredible. I remember that rink when playoff time, it was so packed in there. You look in the, like people were lined up in the, basically in the, up the stairs in that rink. Like yeah. it was crazy how loud and how trying to think of another word to describe it.
Well, it was a circus atmosphere in there. And by the way, if I don't mention Mike Keane, I'll hear about it. Another guy who played there, but no, I don't think the fire marshal ever came in unless he was wearing a Warriors jersey. They didn't really care. Right.
Yeah, no, it was awesome. I mean, the rink had some issues to it. There was a few times I remember coming to the rink after school and you're expecting to go on the ice and practice. And then you look on the ice and, condensation from the roof was dripping on the ice and there were these big mounds of ice all over that made it kind of impossible to practice. But you learn to love it though. When you're there every day and, just the whole experience, it probably took a little time to learn to love it, but, I'll always remember that rink.
It's funny. Some things never change. Bryn was there way before you. I was in there before you. We'd go into the jaw with the Blazers, and there were some bloody good teams there. I mean, Robbie Brown was on that team, Mark Recchi, a whole bunch. This was way before guys like Don't Even came along. This is mid-'80s. Hitch was the coach. We hated playing there. Whether you guys were good or bad or indifferent, it just was not a fun place to play if you weren't a local, you know?
Yeah, that's everybody you talked to just hated that rink. But the only guys that liked it were the ones that, that was their rink. That was their home. That's the only people who loved that rink.
Well, Rob Carney and I set up our broadcast location. It was glassed in. We brought in tropical plants and a heater because we knew the barn was freezing for everybody else. So, and on occasion when Regina would come into town, we'd wear Hawaiian shirts because we wanted it to just, we did everything we could to basically F around with everybody because it was just so much fun. And the fans, it was a great city. I really enjoyed my time there because they were so passionate about it. But I wanted to bring it up because like I said, everybody always says he didn't ask a Moose Jaw Warrior question. So I thought I'd better get to that. But to kind of move, do you want to more on that, Robin, or you want to move on? Because I got a couple other questions too.
I'm good. I want us to talk to Kyle about how that back of his is going to hold up in that world's longest hockey game at Sakers Acres. Because I've been out there. I've seen some pretty healthy men broken down by the time and the cold. I mean, I remember Yanni Nienema came out and played in that game at Sakers Acres. Those guys are nuts, Brodzi. They are so determined. They wrap their feet. They got the blisters. They got but they put on the gear and they keep going out. How did it line up that you signed up for this thing?
A friend of mine from Beggarville, Zanet Karmaniski, actually, he's playing in it, and he's the one who brought it up to me. It would have been about a week or two ago. He just asked if I was interested in. At the time when he asked, I was probably a little scared, a little hesitant to say yes. But after, doing a little bit of research on it, I'm now at the point where I'm grateful that they asked me. I'm really looking forward to it. I think it's for a great cause. I know it's going to be difficult. Everybody who's done it before has said, it's going to be tough, but it's also going to be the time of your life. So, I'm really looking forward to it. And like you said about my back, I, living everyday life, I kind of have a regiment that I have to do to keep my back strong and healthy. And but this is going to be a whole new animal, and I don't know how it's going to react. But I'm going to do the best I can to take care of it. So.
Hey, before we let you go here, and we'll have all the information on the event as we get a little closer to it. So good luck surviving, and watch your toes is what everybody says. Frostbite is usually a problem, although the way this winter's gone, I'm not so sure. Hey, before you go, I got to ask, you played a ton of games. You got to remember one particular goal or one particular moment through your career. Can you sum it up?
Probably the most, right away, the first thought that came into my head was game 7 overtime. I was playing with Minnesota against Colorado. I didn't score the goal. I got an assist, but it was the craziest game that I've ever been a part of. Just a back and forth. We tied it late, I think a couple minutes left. Because they took the lead, I think, two or three different times in the third period. And we just came back, tied it. They'd take the lead. We tied it. So we tied it a few minutes left, heading into overtime. I'm on the ice. They have a very dangerous chance. And they put it towards our net. And it was just, like, I remember it vividly thinking, this is it. It's over. Puck goes to the corner, and Danny Heatley went to the corner to pick up the puck. And meanwhile, myself and Nino Niederreiter, we took off up the ice, and Heater laid this perfect sauce pass right on my tape to make that pass. It was actually, thinking back on it, was that pass he made was incredible. And so then we go up the ice on a 2-on-1, and I feed it over to Nino. He's got the hot hand. Incredible shot. I opened up for him just in case he wanted to pass, which I found out later he wanted to pass the whole time, but their D-man taking it away, and he just ripped one bar down, and just it was probably the best hockey moment I've ever had in my life.
Wow.
There you go.
Hey, listen, thanks for your time. I'd love to catch up with you, and so would Robin, as we the season's just starting. Maybe as we get a little closer towards a playoff round, we'd love to check in with you again, okay? And maybe you can work on broadcasting. You never mentioned broadcasting hockey.
My mom has always kind of brought that up and mentioned that, but I don't know.
It's just as unstable as coaching.
So I get nervous. I don't know if I have the stomach for it. I get nervous just to do an interview on the radio, so I don't know if I'd be able to do it full time.
You've been great. Thanks for your time.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
Okay, so there you go. There's Kyle Brodziak. And we talked earlier with Jamie Cartmell from the Edmonton Oilers, their new director of communications. Hey, before we go too far, we do have to tell you The Outsiders is brought to you by the McIntosh Group at RE/MAX River City. Had a great conversation with Brent McIntosh just last week, talking about the year ahead and how excited they are about things. They're very upbeat about the market. Actually, while there were less homes to sell, they sold faster, and they sold for a little bit more than you would think. So they are quite bullish on 2021, but of course, who knows what new surprises are going to come around the corner this particular calendar year. But the one thing that I've learned about everybody over there and Brent's team is just all you had to do is watch how they dealt with the challenges that were thrown in front of them last year. And while it was a sluggish start to 2020, they finished the year in a rather successful manner. And so obviously, if you're looking to buy or sell a new home, or maybe would like some information, then get a hold of Brent or any of his team at the McIntosh Group at 780-464-0075, or you can also check them out online at mcintoshgroup.ca. Like I said, they're looking for sellers, buyers, and a new agent, and we're thankful that they're back on with us here in 2021 as one of our sponsors. We do appreciate that. Hey, before we kind of wrap things up here, let's talk about the world's longest game of hockey coming up. It's the 4th of February through to the 15th. Brent Sake does an unbelievable job with this and his group. And how many years is this now, Robin, for the world's longest game of hockey?
This will be the 7th edition. First one was 2003. They have raised right at about $5.5 million to this point.
And they work alongside the Cure Cancer Foundation. I'm involved with them with their summer golf tournament and some of their other projects, like the Toast of the Town event. And I'm hoping that we can get back to more normalcy so that both of those two events can be held this coming summer. But you talked about $5 million that Brent and all the hockey players have generated through that event. We've had a chance to go through the Cross Cancer Institute, both as somebody who's curious and on a foundation, and also as a patient. And they have got some unbelievable equipment there that's very expensive. And the last trip that I did through there, they showed me some of the equipment that they've paid off thanks to the world's longest game of hockey. And if you were somebody who contributed to that event in any manner, whether you were a donor or whether or not you played or you just went out and watched and contributed a little cash, you can be proud of everything that has gone right back into the Cross Cancer Institute in Edmonton.
Well, I tell you, Bryn, I've gone out to every single event that they've held. And if you ever want to be inspired, if you ever want to see the best of our humanity here in Alberta, you watch that game and you watch the players play it. What they're fundraising for is so very important and has touched absolutely everybody.
Yeah.
But what they go through every year to raise that money, it really does the heart good. And, you know, I'm not sure where we'll be with COVID regulations between the 4th and the 15th, but no matter what you do, if you can support this group of people, and it's a lot of the same guys come out year after year after year. You know, Kyle Brodziak talked about taking part in it. Yanni Nienema has played in that game. But it's mostly a bunch of people who just give a damn. And 4th to the 15th, can you imagine playing hockey that long? Well, they imagine it because they look at what's the end of that final whistle, and that's the good that fundraising does. So by all means, if you can get behind it, please do.
Okay, before we wrap things up here, we have to tell you we have an email address. If you want to get a hold of us, it's real simple. The email address is theoutsiders@shaw.ca. So that's theoutsiders@shaw.ca. You can also check us out on Twitter. The handle's pretty simple. It's @outsiders2020. So that's @outsiders2020. The other thing, too, make sure that you tell your friends and subscribe to the RSS feed. And that would be on any of your favorite ear candy sites, you know, like Apple, Google, Spotify, Pocket Casts. There's a lot of them out there. And if you subscribe to the RSS feed, the moment we drop a new podcast, you get an immediate download. So, and it'll even tell you there's a new episode out. But most people have figured it out. We're out by Monday afternoon generally. So we appreciate your support. Financial support's also important for us, too. If you are interested in being one of the sponsors like the McIntosh Group, we want to get bigger, we want to get better, and we can only do that with the support of the people who listen and the people who think that there's value in what we're doing. And we're having a lot of fun with this. So I don't think I can say any more than that, Robin.
Nope, it was a hell of a show, and on to the next one. Oh, and between now and the next one, on to the National Hockey League season, if all things go well, Wednesday.
We will have a lot to talk about next week. Robin, thanks. We'll talk to you next week.
Okay, man.
All right.
In the meantime, and in between time, that's it. Another edition. One thing.